guys, delighted to be here tonight. See so many people out for this great forum. Very interesting to follow Hassan. Let me just say, as a prospective NDP candidate, or as an NDP candidate and prospective MP, I couldn't agree with you more about the need for strong social movements to hold power to account. And that goes absolutely as much for the NDP as it does for the Conservatives. So I'm totally in agreement with you on that. Maybe I thought I would maybe just give you a little bit of a sense where I'm coming from. I mean, Judy mentioned my book, The Trouble with Billionaires, which I wrote with Neil Brooks, who's a professor of tax policy at Osgoode Hall Law School. As the title suggests, it's kind of a book about billionaires. And there's a lot of books out about billionaires, but you know, most of those books tend to be about how billionaires are shaping our world and their great achievements and their fascinating lifestyles and everything. I guess I would just point out that our book kind of takes its inspiration more from the group of protesters who marched down Wall Street right after the 2008 financial crash. I mean, so my focus has been heavily on inequality, and particularly, you know, like when we talk about inequality, it's important, we're talking about essentially a massive transfer of income and wealth from ordinary Canadians to those at the very top. Really one of the most significant, if not the most far-reaching change in our society in this generation. And yet the stunning thing is, until recently, it was a subject that wasn't really even discussed. And I think to the extent that it's discussed today, we owe that to the Occupy Wall Street movement. The ultimate in a kind of social forum held right there on Wall Street. And so we are talking about the subject of inequality, and of course we hear it come out in terms of the crunch on the middle class and that kind of thing. I guess what strikes me is, first of all, it is great that there is some new focus, let's say, on poverty, the rise of the precariat, etc. But what isn't happening, and this is certainly not the fault of Occupy Wall Street, because Occupy Wall Street very much did make this a central focus, but the discussion about inequality shouldn't just be about too much poverty at the bottom, but it should be also about too much richness at the top. You know? And that was, of course, the message of Occupy Wall Street about the danger of giving too much wealth and power to the 1%, or the 0.1% or the 0.01%. And the reason for that is not just that, you know, it creates an incredibly unfair situation where the people at the top gobble up such a large share of the country's resources, or the world's resources for that matter, but it also means an enormous switch in power to those at the top. Because that's what, you know, wealth ultimately is about power. And well, actually, there's some great quotes on this, if I can quote Louis Brandeis, who's a former, late Supreme Court Justice in the United States, who made the quote. He said, you can have concentration of wealth in the hands of the few, or you can have democracy, but you can't have both. Same idea was expressed a little more crudely by Mark Hanna, who was a Republican strategist in the late 19th century, and he put it this way. He said, there are two things that matter in politics. The first is money, and I can't remember what the second is. It is sort of true that what we've essentially seen in recent years, in the recent decades, with the, you know, as we've submitted to this neoliberal agenda, this Thatcherism, Reaganism, whatever you want to call it. What we've seen is the rise of corporate power, the rise of the power of a very small group of a corporate elite. And that has the effect of increasing the inequality, because one of the major things they do with their power is, of course, increase their wealth. So that's why we see in the tax changes and the changes to our corporate law and the attack on unions that Hassan talked about so eloquently, we see this enormous economic benefit that they're creating for themselves. And just to give you a snapshot of this, 30 years ago, the top group of CEOs in Canada had an average income that was 25 times the ordinary worker's wage. Today, it's 250 times the average worker's wage. And let's not forget that 25 times is dramatic enough, but 250 times is kind of sickening. And in some sectors, it's even worse. In the financial sector, that concentration is even more extreme. So for instance, just to give you one particularly revolting example, John Paulson, who's a famous hedge fund manager, in 2009, he made in 1 year $3.7 billion. That was his income, okay? And he made it by betting against the subprime mortgage market, and in the process helping to push the world into a recession from which we still are not fully recovered. So that year, that guy had not 25 times the average income or 250 times the average income. He had 80,000 times the average income. In other words, he had as much income as 80,000 nurses. Now, I mean, I just ask you, in what moral universe is that guy worth the same as 80,000 nurses? In what moral universe is that guy worth the same as what? apart from the just revolting increase in inequality that we've seen, there's also the problem that the 1%, the corporate elite, uses its power not just to make itself richer, which is bad enough, but to influence just about everything else on the political agenda, including, for instance, things like climate change. You know, so often we tend to think, or you hear in public discussion, that climate change, you know, that there's all this resistance, the public is, you know, they won't give up their SUVs or they're lazy recycling or taking a bicycle or whatever. In fact, I think the evidence is pretty clear, and the polls consistently show that in fact the public is actually gets it, actually understands the scope of the seriousness of the problem. That the real problem, the resistance, is the resistance offered by the fossil fuel lobby, which is, of course, the most powerful set of interests that's ever been assembled in history. And they have been fighting tooth and nail to block the progress of action on climate change. And I think it's really striking, if you look at the difference, for instance, between what's happened with climate change and the ability of the fossil fuel lobby to block action on it. And the difference between that and what happened in an earlier crisis that was actually somewhat similar, a generation earlier, that is the crisis of ozone layer depletion. Back in the 70s and 80s, a similar kind of problem of global proportions similarly roused the international community, got the UN working on a massive project to alert the world and get scientists all over the world to give their express their alarm about what was happening. But the same thing, and also the same thing in terms of a small corporate elite led by General Electric and DuPont that were, you know, actively, vigorously opposing ozone layer depletion action. But to make a long story short, despite the enormous power of the corporate elite, the public interest actually prevailed in that case. And I would argue that that was because at that point, the corporate ascendancy that we see today hadn't fully occurred. Yes, corporations were always powerful, but they weren't powerful to the point back then that they're powerful today. So for instance, there was a worldwide movement that pressured governments and even conservative governments, like the Mulroney government here in Canada, the George H.W. Bush government in the United States, ultimately felt pressured enough by this movement that they got behind it and actually ended up bringing in something called the Montreal Protocol, which has been considered a huge success in environmental circles in terms of dealing with that problem, which is why we don't hear too much about it today. And I would argue it's because of the tremendous increase in corporate power that we've seen in the last 2 to 3 decades that we have had so little ability to actually bring this climate change problem under the control of governments and popular movements around the world. So I would just argue, in conclusion, it's so interesting because, of course, what the right-wing governments always try and do today is imply, that the fight is between jobs and climate, right? And that sort of trying to pit the struggle, ordinary people versus the need to save the environment. Well, as we showed last Sunday at that fabulous march that was led by the labor movement in conjunction with environmental groups, there is no contradiction between jobs and climate. That in fact, any reasonable attempt to deal with the climate will inevitably involve expanding the green revolution, which is just a wonderful job creator. The problem isn't jobs and labor versus the environment. The problem is corporate power. And that is ultimately what we want.